which is When I Needed a Neighbour, which I think everybody will know, so enjoy. When we are unkind to people and forget they are God's children.
Master, forgive us and make us new.
When we are careless with our animals and forget they are God's creation.
Father, forgive us and make us new.
When we ill-treat the land and forget God and ask us to look after it.
Father, forgive us and make us new.
When we are too ready to complain and too slow to say thank you.
Father, forgive us.
each other's needs.
Father, forgive us and make us new.
When we are deliberately deaf to the cries of the hungry, the poor and the suffering,
Father, forgive us and make us new.
When we take all we have for granted and forget to be generous,
Father, forgive us and make us new.
And may our sins be forgiven, our blindness and deafness be healed, our hearts be softened. May your life-giving Spirit rest on us and fill our nation and world with your hope and love. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you very much, Harry. That was great.
Most important commandment, Mark 12. One of the religion scholars came up, hearing the lively exchanges of question and answer, and seeing how sharp Jesus was in his answers. He put in his question, which is most important of all the commandments? Jesus said, the first in importance is, listen Israel, the Lord your God is one. So love the Lord God with all your passion and prayer and intelligence and energy. And here is the second. Love others as well as you love yourself. There is no other commandment that ranks with these. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
And now Debbie is going to read for us the letter to Philemon.
This is one of those very rare occasions where you actually get a whole book in one reading. A letter from Paul to Philemon. I, Paul, am a prisoner for the sake of Christ, here with my brother Timothy. I write this letter to you, Philemon, my good friend and companion in this work, Also to our sister Afia, to Archippus, a real trooper, and to the church that meets in your house. God's best to you. Christ's blessings on you. Every time your name comes up in my prayers, I say, oh, thank you, God. I keep hearing of the love and faith you have for the Master Jesus, which brims over to other believers. And I keep praying that this faith we hold in common keeps showing up in the good things we do, and that people recognize Christ in all of it. Friend, you have no idea how good your love makes me feel. Doubly so when I see your hospitality to fellow believers. In line with all this, I have a favour to ask of you. As Christ's ambassador, and now a prisoner for him, I wouldn't hesitate to command this if I thought it necessary, but I'd rather make it a personal request. While here in jail, I've fathered a child, so to speak, and here he is, hand-carrying this letter, Onesimus. He was useless to you before, but now he's useful to both of us. I'm sending him back to you, but it feels like I'm cutting off my right arm in doing so. I wanted, in the worst way, to keep him here as your stand-in, to help out while I'm in jail for the message. But I didn't want to do anything behind your back, make you do a good deed that you haven't willingly agreed to. Maybe it's all for the best that you lost him for a while. You're getting him back now for good, and no mere slave this time, but a true Christian brother. That's what he was to me. He'll be even more than that to you. So, if you consider me a comrade in arms, welcome him back as you would me. If he damaged anything or owes you anything, chalk it up to my account. This is my personal signature, Paul, and I stand behind it. I don't need to remind you, do I, that you owe your very life to me. Do me this big favour, friend. You'll be doing it for Christ, but it will also do my heart good. I know you well enough to know you will. You'll probably go far beyond what I've written. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Guys, we need some help here because we've got a quiz coming up. Can you feel the excitement going through? Are you walking as well, Harry? That's great. I can feel the excitement going through the whole of the church and online as well. Okay, so our first question is, was St. Paul a tent maker or a carpenter? Now, Harry and James, put your name there, I just found James. Harry and James are going to count up how many people put hands up for each one. So if you think St. Paul was a tent maker, put your hand up. Okay, can you count? When did Paul write his letter trying to get it in the opposite, but not quite succeeding. Okay, now if you think it was 42 AD, put your hand up.
No.
If you think it was 52 AD, put your hand up.
Don't just follow me.
Already put your hand up. Okay, James, your turn. had gone and looked after all the belongings of the people who had stoned Stephen. And he then went to the Jerusalem council, to the high priest, and he said, could you give me a letter to go and persecute, to punish the citizens in Damascus who are Christians? And they said yes. And then on the road to Damascus, Jesus did a bolt of lightning and said, why are you punishing my people? And that was St. Paul's conversion to becoming a Christian. Okay, our next letter, our next question. Did Paul write letters to the Corinthians or the Venetians? Right. If you think it's Venetians, put your hands up.
One.
We've got one. Okay. And if you think it's Corinthians, put your hands up.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27.
Wow. Okay. Now, if you haven't already put your hand up, put your hand up. People have caught on to this one now. Nobody's put their hand up. Okay, your turn, Harry.
You are clever.
Okay, and that is the end of our quiz. I think we need a round. That's a different one. We're moving on now. Let's tell a story. So you two need to go and sit down and listen to the story. All right. But I think we need a round of applause for our. Who was his master. Now, you might not know, or you might know, but I'm going to tell you anyway whether you know or not, but back in the Roman times, slaves were owned by their master. And in the same way that we might own a dog, or a cat, or a goldfish now, we owned people. So Philemon owned Onesimus. One of the things that Jesus had told people when he was alive was that you actually follow, you actually kind of do whatever your role is in life. So if you were a slave, you would be a slave to the best of your ability and love people. If you were a master, you would do the same. You would try to be the best master you could be. Now, Onesimus, after many adventures, comes to St. Paul, who is in prison. And Onesimus learns about Jesus, and he becomes a Christian. Paul, who is in prison, is very lonely. He's probably been in prison for quite a long time, and Paul loves to be out doing things. He loves to be out preaching the gospel, converting people to becoming Christians. And Onesimus is like a son to him. And he longs to keep Onesimus with him. And we hear in the reading that Debbie read out to us, that Paul wanted to keep him for the very worst reasons, and that was because he wanted a companion and the comfort of Onesimus with him. But Paul knows that because he is a follower of Jesus, he can't do that. That's something he just can't do, because it would be lying, and it would be doing this behind Philemon's back. So he tells the truth, and Paul asks Philemon to welcome Onesimus back as a brother of Christ, because Philemon and Onesimus both believe in Jesus. Now, Philemon could do all sorts of things to Onesimus because he was a slave, and to run away as a slave was a really big crime at that time. Onesimus could be put in prison. But Paul asked Philemon to free Onesimus because they are both brothers together in Christ. Paul says to Philemon that Onesimus is better than when he first came.
than when he first ran away. Because Onesimus ran away because he was scared. There was something that had happened that had made him run away. But now he's coming back knowing Jesus. You've also got to think of Onesimus. Onesimus had a choice in this. He could actually choose not to face possible punishments by firing them. He could have just run away and thought, I'm not doing this. But in actual fact, he decided not to do that. He decided to take this letter to Philemon and go and face what he'd done wrong. And that takes a lot of courage. And my guess is that a lot of the time, the things that we do that need courage, we need God to help us with. And that's what was happening with Philemon. Because he didn't know what punishment he could get. He could have been put in prison, he could have been whipped. But Paul asked for Philemon to be merciful because of his love for Jesus and because Jesus asked us to forgive those who harm us. Now that is the tale of Philemon, Onesimus and Paul. And I wish I could tell you I knew what happened. But unfortunately, we only have this one letter in the Bible. We don't have the whole story of what happened when Onesimus and Philemon met. I decided I was going to do a bit of thinking about what might have happened. So I've come up with a couple of ideas that might have happened. The first one is Onesimus and Philemon were reconciled and made a new start because of the love they each had for Paul and for Jesus. Both of them loved Paul, but more importantly, they had both been converted to be Christians and they both loved Jesus. The other one that isn't actually on the screen is that Philemon, in a great act of generosity, freed Onesimus and sent him back to Paul so that Onesimus could continue being Paul's servant and comforting him. And being given your freedom as a slave was a great thing because it meant you were no longer owned by anybody else. You were your free person. And we all value our freedom. Can you imagine being a slave to somebody else in this church? It would be awful. So those are the things that I've thought about. Whatever happened, it was a new start for Onesimus and Philemon. And September is a time of new starts. It's a time when children go back to school.
Yay!
It's a time when parents celebrate.
Teachers go back as well.
It's a time when teachers go back. That's all. To be a child when you go back to school, and I was trying to go back those many, many years, and I was thinking, I wondered who my new teacher was going to be, whether I'd like them or not. Would I like my new class? Would people be nice to me? I didn't want to go back to school because I didn't really like school, and I wanted to have the holidays. Holidays were great, school could have skipped it. It's also a time, though, for us who don't go to school to start to plan new things. So people might start a new job. And just by coincidence, I start a new job tomorrow. It's not a great change. Rather than supporting people with mental health problems, I'm going to be supporting people with any health condition or any disability. But it is a change, which is good. So September, new start for me. It's also a time when people start new hobbies, or they go on a new course, or they think, I'm going to do something different. This is going to be a time to do something different. But one of the advantages of following Jesus is that we can make a new start anytime. God wants us all to make a new start in following him. And that is really important. And we can do this every day. That every new day we get a chance to follow Jesus. Every Sunday, we get a chance to follow Jesus in a different way to a way we might have done before. We might want to do things differently. In the commandments, the most important Jesus gave us, which Graham read out. Jesus said, love your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind. He said that because that is the most important thing we can do. And I don't know about you, but there are times where I have doubts, there are times where I struggle, there are times where it feels really hard to follow Jesus, and faith is just about sticking in there and knowing that Jesus is there. But having that commandment in our minds helps us to be able to do that. The second commandment that he gave is, love your neighbour as yourselves. And that's really a hard one. And we've got a few things up there that might demonstrate that. So we've got two people talking together, listening to each other. We've got a heart that's held in hands. That's showing that we're loving ourselves, because that is really important. Sometimes it can be really difficult to love ourselves, but that is one of the most important things we can do. Be kind to ourselves. We have a person there who's giving money to somebody, and that I think is going to become more important as time goes on over the winter, because we're all aware of the cost of living crisis and what's going to happen to energy crisis and what's happening to inflation. So being generous, if we're able to be generous, is going to be even more important. And then we have somebody helping a person up a hill and holding out their hand to them. And that is a responsibility that we all have to help others. But the one thing that we might find more difficult than that is actually accepting help for ourselves. We all need help at some time, and God offers that help, but we also need to be able to accept that help. And I don't know about you, but I was speaking about pride last week. Pride sometimes stops me accepting that help. Now, Paul's letter to Philemon was sent nearly 2,000 years ago. Not quite, but nearly 2,000 years ago. But the message that is given there is just as important now as it was then, about making a new start. So when we think about a new start, we think about love of God, love of our neighbour, love of ourselves, but we can only do that with God's love. Now, Debbie and I were talking yesterday, and we were talking about how God is always present here. God is always here, and God is always with us. But one of the things that we might struggle is to tune in, and Debbie, I'm nicking this from you, Debbie, by the way.
It's fine.
But tuning in is the radio. Now, how many of you remember Radio Luxembourg? Oh, lots of people remember Radio Luxembourg. So this was back in the late 1960s, early 1970s. So we're really talking about the olden days. And those people who just put a hand up have just proved how old they were. But people used to have these little radios, and you used to tune it in. And you were looking for, was it 207 you were looking for? People can't remember that. Anyway, you were tuning in, and sometimes you get it spot on, and you'd hear all the pop songs absolutely perfectly. Sometimes you'd tune it in, and it'd be just slightly off key, and you'd hear the pop songs, but they'd be like tinny on. It would just be kind of not quite right. And sometimes you tune it in, and you get absolutely nothing. And tuning into God is a little bit like that. Sometimes you tune in, and things are absolutely great. God is there with you, and you can feel that, and you can feel that in your relationship with God. Other times, though, you tune in, it's just slightly there. Another time, you tune in, and you can't find God at all. And that is to do with us and how we are, because God is always there. But when we're struggling to find God, it's about remembering the times when we tuned in and it was spot on. Those are the times that we need to remember, because sometimes when we have doubts, it is about going through and carrying on, even though it feels difficult. So, new start. Love your God with all your heart, soul, and strength. and love your neighbour as yourself. Remember, that includes being kind to yourselves. Thank you very much to Harry and James for their help. And we're now going to sing our next song, which is one of my favourites. It's How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds. Please stand.
Knowing that our loving God supplies all our needs, let us pray to him now on behalf of the church and the world. Father, we offer this time and the love of our hearts as we pray for the church with all its varied ministries, for the youngest to the oldest baptized members, for those of mellow faith and those who struggle with doubts. We pray particularly this week for the Diocese of Leeds and for the clergy conference in Liverpool, that it would be a time of inspiration and encouragement. We pray for our bishops. We pray for all clergy and laity working together to build your kingdom in this diocese. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we offer our commitment to pray the news each day and share the pain we read about, longing for your peace and your justice in a world tense with aggression and distorted with selfishness, where love is often not seen. We pray this week as a new Prime Minister will be put into number 10 Downing Street. We pray for them as they consider how they are going to address the cost of living crisis. And we pray for their government as they seek to take measures that will help us all. We pray for those affected by climate change, and especially those affected in Pakistan by the floods. We ask, Lord, that you would be there in the middle of that tragedy, that you would help those who are providing rescue efforts, that you would be next to the grieving and those who have lost everything. And we pray especially for the Western world as we struggle with what to do about climate change, that we may be sacrificial and brave in making the decisions needed to safeguard this planet. We pray for Russia and Ukraine, for peace, for justice, and for forgiveness. And as we think of the listeners today, we pray for all of those who are the victims of human trafficking and of slavery, the many millions in this world who are slaves. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we offer our homes and our relationships for you to work in and to transform. We offer you our meetings and our conflicts and all differences of opinion for you to use to your glory. We think of our community, and we pray particularly for our schools, for all those going back to school next week, whether they be staff or students. We pray for new beginnings, for hope, and for your presence, thinking especially of the schools in our area. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we offer you our solidarity with all who suffer or are heavily burdened. Hear us as we pray for their comfort and refreshment, wholeness and restoration, but above all, for the consciousness of your presence in their pain and your love for them. We pray today particularly for all who are in hospital or receiving hospice care. And we include Sophie P, Canon Christine Bullimore, Roy, Paul H, Ken, Sophie H, Alan S, Sharon H, Marion, Brian F, Nancy M, Maria, Denise G, Daniel, Daryl, Linda, Penny, Danny, Vivian, Amryn, Alison, and Jill, as well as those who have begun long-term medical treatment. We pray also for those who are recently married or baptized, for those to be baptized this afternoon, and for those confirmed and ordained. And in a moment's quiet, we lift to God those known to us who are in particular need today. We pray too for Sally and Richard, both struggling with COVID. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we offer our thanks for lives well lived, for faithful souls entering by the gate of physical death to eternal life with you. Prepare us all to meet you face to face. We pray for those who are dying now, for those who care for them, and for those who will mourn them. We think of the recently departed, including Marjorie and Lillian, as well as those whose years mind occurs at this time, thinking particularly of Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we give you our lives as well as our words of praise, so that each moment from now on becomes an offering of love. Help us to make a new start. Help us to tune in to you. Help us to love you with all our hearts, souls, minds, and strength, and to love our neighbours as we love ourselves. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
And we gather all these prayers together, as our Saviour taught us to pray. We say together, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
I'm getting the steps in this morning, aren't I? The notices. First notice is that you will have all been aware, having watched the news, of the dreadful situation in Pakistan, and the Disasters Emergency Commission are currently doing their best to raise as much funds as they can to bring relief to those poor people who've been left with nothing and many who are grieving. We have decided that over the next 2 weeks we will give people an opportunity to put some money to one side to send to the DEC on behalf of the benefits. So if you would like to make a donation, I appreciate you may not have brought any money with you today, and that's fine, we'll be doing this again next week. But if you would like to make a donation, then where would you like the donation put in? Church warden? Wardens? Marion, thank you so much. There's a collection plate by the door. If you want to put any money specifically for the DEC and for Pakistan, then can you please do that there, and remember next week as well. John?
If we give through the benefits,
yes.
It can't be given here. If we are taxpayers and we give directly,
yeah.
It can't be given.
Right. I'll think about how we do that then.
Well, no, we can't do it collectively.
No, I know.
But rather than give directly through the benefits, people might give through the benefits. They might
give individually, absolutely. Whichever you would prefer to do. What we might do is the money is collected, I might then send a personal donation, which could be gift aided. No, I can't do that. I'm shaking his head at me.
It's illegal.
It's illegal. Yeah. All right. Scrap that. Anybody online who's recording this or whatever, I did not say that because I hate to get arrested. Don't want to end up like that Paul. Okay, so if you want to give through the benefits, leave some money there. If you don't, or if you want some help in how to make a donation to the DEC, come and let us know. And the only other notice that I have is about the murder mystery on Friday. At the moment, there aren't enough people down to go. This is being held at Whitley. It's being hosted by the church, but held in the community centre. It's being done by professional actors, but they need a specific number of people. If you would like to go, the tickets have been reduced in price significantly, so please contact Marjorie. She will need to know very soon if you want to go. I think it's been dude. I think it's been reduced to
£15
for an adult and £10 for a child. So if you'd like to go, please let Marjorie know as soon as possible, so that if it can go ahead, that would be brilliant. And I don't believe there are any... Oh, yes, Brian.
Two notes on this...
On this lecture, the Heritage Weekend.
What about Heritage Weekend and the Community Choir?
Okay. Heritage Weekend events. September the 17th and 18th. Hope you're not planning on doing anything else except being here, because there's stuff going on. We've got an illustrated talk by Chris Butlin, who will apparently be wearing an Edwardian costume, and he's going to be talking about one of my predecessors. We've got some very illustrious predecessors in this church. I don't think anybody's going to have too much of a problem following me, but I have more of a problem following the Reverend John Michel, who was a former rector, and the man who first postulated the possibility of black holes. And that's on Saturday the 17th of September at 11 o'clock. And on Sunday the 18th, at 2:45, there's going to be a talk by Stuart Hartley, who's a local historian, about prominent Thornhill people, like John Rudd, another former rector, who was also a cartographer. There will be free cakes and tea. Well, there will be free cakes, if you provide them. See, there's always a thing in the tail, isn't there? So please, generously, bake away. Because we're hoping that lots of people are going to come and they're going to enjoy the history and the beauty of this place, but hopefully at the same time encounter Jesus, because that's why we're here. And Thornhill Community Choir have a new conductor, Charlie Murray, who's from Musical.ly Hercules, and we are welcoming them back on Tuesday the 13th of September. The church will be open from 4:15 with singing from 4:30 to 5:30. Join them every week in term time if you want to have a good sing. And I can tell you now, singing is brilliant for your health. So, there's no age limit, no auditions, just a willingness to sing together. So if you can come along, please do. Anything else? Excellent, thank you.
Right, we're on to our last song now. We are marching. We are marching in the light of God. Now, we haven't got any instruments, but what I'd like you to do is make your own noise in whatever way you want. It can be clapping, it can be stamping, it can be clapping your head, however you want to do it. But let's make a bit of noise. Okay, so are we ready, Brian?
We are marching.
service. We hope you enjoyed it, especially the last song, which was fun. No, there was quite a bit of laughing going on, but it was fun. And we have tea, biscuits, not sure there's any cake, but certainly tea, biscuits.